This lesson is on the end of the American Civil War. It'll talk a little bit about Sherman's March to the Sea, although we've chatted about that already, so it won't be too much. Appomattox Courthouse, where the last major army of the South surrendered, and the assassination of President Lincoln when the war was actually over. Sherman's March. As you can see from the picture, and we've talked about this before, Sherman's March to the Sea was a little bit different than all the other battles ahead of it. It was total war. As you can see, that the Northern soldiers here in blue are not really shooting at, you know, Confederate soldiers in gray. They're ripping up railroad tracks right there. They're burning buildings and factories and cotton gins and things like that, stealing food and other types of things like that. On the top of your paper, we have Sherman's March, and that was a total war situation. And I know we've talked about the definition of total war in our last class, but I would like to do it again just to make sure, because it is important, and it will be on your final, I'm sorry, your unit test. Total war is a war against the whole enemy nation. You're not just fighting against the enemy army in the field. You're fighting against the enemy's farms that are in Louisiana, and you're fighting against their factories that they might have in Georgia, and you're fighting against their people that are supporting and writing positive letters to the soldiers that are living in, you know, South Carolina or Virginia or something like that. Total war. You're a war against the whole enemy nation. Everybody. Nothing is off limits. This is the movie on Sherman's March that we saw in our last class, so I'm not going to show it to you again. Now, I'm going to talk about Petersburg, Richmond, Appomattox Courthouse. Richmond is, the capital of the Confederacy, and that was the goal of a lot of Union armies and the Army of the Potomac, and that was what Robert E. Lee and his Confederate Army of Northern Virginia was trying to protect. He was surrounded, basically, around Richmond by the army of Ulysses S. Grant. The battle does extend to Petersburg, but this battle was a siege, so it lasted a long, long, long time. And during that time, Robert E. Lee's forces dwindled, they starved, they ran out of food, they were running out of gun parts and things like that, so it was really a bad situation for Robert E. Lee. Now, in the movie clip that you guys are going to see, this is where Robert E. Lee's army was finally captured. This is a house, the house of Wilbur McLean. There's an ironic story about Wilbur McLean. It'll be in the movie clip. I won't relate it right here. But Robert E. Lee's army was suffering tremendously, as you can see from the picture over here. They eventually retreat out of the capital of Richmond to try to get some food, to try to get away from the Union Army. They don't get either for Robert E. Lee. It's unfortunate for him. And they are caught by the Northern Army of the Potomac and Ulysses S. Grant at Appomattox Courthouse. And this house right here is where the surrender took place, and you can see a painting of the interior of that house right here. You have Robert E. Lee dressed up really nice here. You have Ulysses S. Grant not so nicely dressed, and I'll talk about that in the movie clip. Now, there's going to be a movie clip coming up here. Please be paying attention and write down the information, because at the end of it, it will talk about who won the American Civil War, and that's definitely, definitely an important question that you have to be knowing and answering and stuff like that.
Appomattox Courthouse. Confederate General Robert E. Lee's army has grown weak in 4 years of war. Driven out of their fortified lines near Richmond, they are chased west by a vastly larger Union army. Cut off from supplies, Lee realizes that the game is up.
And Robert E. Lee turns to his staff and says, I have no other choice but to go meet with General Grant, and I would rather die 1,000 deaths.
Lee and Grant meet in Appomattox Courthouse, Virginia. Lee is turned out in his finest dress uniform. Grant in mud-stained everyday clothes. The two men who have been fighting for over a year come to quick agreement on the surrender terms.
One of the striking things about the meeting between Grant and Lee at Appomattox is the sense of understanding that was manifested between the two generals. Partly this reflected the fact that they knew each other from before the war, but they also had been through this horrible experience together. And so when he offered quite generous terms of surrender to Lee, it was a manifestation of this understanding, but also of a deeper sense that the nation had been at war, and now it had to bind itself back together. Reconstruction, in a military sense, began at that moment when Lee and Grant met at Appomattox Courthouse.
The surrender takes place in a house belonging to Wilmer McLean. 4 years earlier, McLean had lived in Manassas, Virginia, site of the first major battle of the war.
So after the Battle of Manassas, he decides he's got to get out of this theater of war, and so he moves his family to what he thinks is a fairly remote location, a place called Appomattox Courthouse, also in Virginia. And it's in his house, where he had moved 4 years earlier to escape the war, that the final surrender ceremonies take place.
The fighting that had begun in McLean's front yard draws to a close in his front parlor. Other Confederate surrenders follow, and by June of 1865, the war that has left more than half a million Americans dead is finally at an end.
Now, once Robert E. Lee surrendered, Abraham Lincoln very quickly went to Richmond, Virginia from the American capital, Washington, D.C. He got on a boat and sailed down the Potomac and then sailed up the Rappahannock, went to Richmond, Virginia. He gets off this boat. No one was expecting him. He only had, as you can see from the picture over here, he only had one, I wouldn't even call him a security guard. He was kind of like a butler manservant that happened to have a pistol in his pocket. There weren't any soldiers waiting for him. He wandered basically alone around the capital of Richmond, Virginia, which was filled with thousands and thousands of Confederates that were very upset that the North was winning and that that Robert E. Lee had left. But that didn't matter. Abraham Lincoln walked through the streets of Richmond, Virginia with his young son, as you can see here, and the crowds of people that did come up around him were all these former slaves. Okay, they're ex-slaves, and because, again, if the North is going to win, second Northern War goal, free the slaves. So this is what makes Lincoln go down in history as the great emancipator, the great freedom giver, because he created the Emancipation Proclamation. He was the President of the United States when the South surrendered and lost their right to have slaves. This picture over here is a picture of what Richmond, Virginia looked like at the very end of the war. As you can see, total war. None of these buildings are standing. This is the business district of Richmond, Virginia. All of these would have been three or four or five or six story tall buildings. They're all burned out. They're all knocked down and stuff like that from the war. Now, for this reading, Abraham Lincoln's second inaugural address. An inaugural address is not really something you hear about too much. An inaugural address is the name of a speech that a president gives right when he takes the oath of office. He puts his hand on the Bible. He says, you know, he says I want to be the president of the United States. I do. And then he goes over to the crowd, and then he gives a little speech, basically kind of, you know, hey, this is what I'm going to do, thanks for voting for me kind of thing. This is Lincoln's second one because he got elected twice. All right. Now I'm going to read this through, and on your paper, I need you to underline any words that you're having trouble with, and then I'll pause the movie, and then we'll go over those words. Okay? Now, here's how it sounds. And the things that are in parentheses are the definitions of the word right in front of it. So, with malice toward none, with charity for all, with firmness in the right, as God gives us to see the right, let us strive on to finish the work we are in, to bind up the nation's wounds, to care for him in battle, to care for him who shall have borne the battle, and for his widow and his orphan, to do all which may achieve and cherish a just and lasting peace among ourselves and with all nations. All right, so I'm going to pause this, take a second, we'll go over any words you're still having trouble with. Now, what I need everyone to do is to circle this section. Don't circle the whole thing because that's cheating. Circle the section, and it doesn't really require any more than 5 or 6 words, that shows Lincoln's attitude towards the Southern people once the war is over. Lincoln gives this inaugural address in the spring of 1865. It is, the war is not over. The North could still lose, but things are looking really good. Vicksburg has happened. Sherman's March to the Sea has happened. Robert E. Lee is surrounded at in Virginia. He hasn't escaped yet, but he's on his last legs. It's looking pretty bad. But Lincoln is looking forward. He's looking ahead to, okay, once the war is over and the North wins, what are we going to do with the South? So circle the part there that kind of talks about that. All right, this graph here I pulled together. It shows a comparison of the United States of America, United States, the North, 2 million total dudes in the army, and the number of killed, the wounded, the total between those two, and the percentage. What percentage of 640,000 casualties? What percent is that of 2 million? Okay, a little over 2 million. So this is the part, and this is the whole. 30% of all the men in the Northern Army would have become casualties. Southerners, they have a much smaller army. Their whole is much smaller. Their casualties are smaller, okay, in total than the North. But if you were in the Southern Army, you had a 37% chance of becoming a casualty, all right? So you can answer the question B underneath the chart there, which is fairly simple now. Also, 1 million over 1 million casualties total for the American Civil War. This is the bloodiest war in American history. No other war in American history has ever come close to the casualties that the Civil War did. In fact, you can add up most of the other wars that we've been involved in, and you total all the other wars together, you start to come close to the number of casualties that were in the Civil War. So a tremendously bloody, horrible experience, no doubt about it. But the North wins, so at least the slaves are freed. Okay, so there is some value in that. Lincoln's assassination. If we have time at the end, I'll tell you a story about what happens before Lincoln gets assassinated. This is a picture of John Wilkes Booth, an incredibly famous actor in the North and the South in 1865. Excuse me. He's the one who assassinated Abraham Lincoln. This is a major somebody or other who ended up getting roped into going to the theater that night with the Lincolns, Abe Lincoln and his wife Mary Todd Lincoln, right there. Now, I'm going to pause the movie so you can watch the movie on the Lincoln assassination.
Don't desperate. Yeah, we're both having heir to the fortune.
Not heir?
What? The fortune?
Yeah, hear my heart and my head, just as she wants them, with nothing in them.
Hold up, dear, to your heart.
Yes.
I am aware, Mr. Shaw, that you are not accustomed to good society, and that is due to the imprisonment which you have guilty.
Don't know the manners of good society, huh? Well, I guess I know enough to turn you inside out, old gal. Like to apologize for old man's presence.
Why did the North win the Civil War? Well, as you can see from the graphs, there are seven graphs here, and the North, which is the darker colors here, the North had more of everything. They had more factories, they had a larger population, they have more shipping, which is things you can move from place to place, they had more railroad mileage, more men in the army, their value of the things that they made was much greater, which kind of goes with value of manufacturing and factories. Those two things kind of go together. The more factories you have, the more valuable stuff you can make. Your army is big because you have a big population. Look at the numbers on that. That's almost exactly the same. 29% of the population of America was in the South, and 30% of the population in the South, southern population, was in their army. So very close, right? The only thing that the South has going for it is the value of their exports, right? So that was really just the cotton. And not that cotton's a bad thing, but cotton's not really super useful in a war. You can't throw cotton at someone and hurt them, okay? And the Southerners did use cotton to build like some forts and to stop bullets, which it does stop bullets if you have big bales of it, but it catches on fire very easily, so that wasn't really super helpful either. So your answer for that question C should be that the North had more of everything. They dominated. That would be a great word to put in your answer. They dominated the South in all of the important aspects, okay, and factories and men and mileage and shipping and things like that. All right, so that's your answer there. Next one. This one I find interesting too. Not only were the Northerners dominant in, you know, manufacturing and railroads and stuff like that, but the South was really getting squeezed because of the lack of food. And whenever time you have a scarcity, a lack of something, the cost goes up. That's why gold is expensive. There's very little of it on the planet. But sand is not expensive, okay? Because there is so much of it. Food became very scarce in the South, and as you can see, the prices of the food went up tremendously. What I would like you to do on your paper there is for question D and E, use this information. How much money would it take for a Confederate soldier to buy 2 dozen eggs, 2 quarts of milk, 1 pound of butter, and 1/2 pound of coffee? I'm giving you some room here to show your work. Okay, so you're going to do, that's question D on your paper. And then I would like you to, once you get done with D, do E. How many months' pay would that be? And you also need to show your work. I know it's really dark on your paper, but down here, a Confederate soldier's monthly pay was $18. Okay, so I'm going to give you some time. Do these two questions and just imagine what it would be like to only be able to have 2 dozen eggs, 2 quarts of milk, 1/2 pound of coffee, 1 pound of butter. How many months, more than one, would it take for a Confederate to buy that? And remember, he's got to buy his food, he's got to buy food for his wife, his kids, and stuff like that. And this is all they would be able to buy. This is all they'd be able to get. So, again, that's going to show you another hardship, another problem. All right? That's it. Do your work, and we'll come back later.